Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. If you've been to one of these sessions before, we're doing these sessions every Wednesday, and they are our Meet the Team Wednesdays. So every week we're meeting a different member of the Tessabide Productions team. They might be permanent members of the team, or they might be some of our amazing freelancers that come and work on specific projects. And we're doing this partly because in lockdown all of our gigs have been cancelled, so we're thinking of other ways to connect with you guys and to keep ourselves busy. But in another way is because when we make shows, and we often go into schools when we're making them, quite often when we're doing kind of our work in progress showings and we introduce the team to various groups of children and teachers, we're always asked about what it actually means to do these creative jobs, especially those jobs that aren't the visible ones, the actors, the directors. And today couldn't be more perfect for that reason. Today is a really super exciting one. Today we have Nina Dunn, who is a video and projection designer. She has worked on huge scale projects in the West End to tiny little fringe shows, including a show that Tessabye Productions are producing at the moment called Bob. Nina's also the joint head of video and digital at RADA, and she's going to be here today to talk about what her work involves, what her career has involved, and to answer any of your questions. So, before I head over to Nina, if you have any questions while she's talking about what she does, then please do just write your comment in the your question in the comments. And after Nina's done a little bit of chat, I'll be asking her your questions and some questions from me as well. So, without further ado, hello, Nina Dunn. Hi, Nina.
Hi everyone, how are you?
Thanks so much for coming.
Yeah, good. It's great to be here with you, Tessa. And hi anyone who happens to be tuning in. I'm as Tessa said, I'm a video and projection designer. Not many people know what that means, not my parents, nobody really. So it's a good chance to tell you all a bit about it. Like quite a few theatre practitioners, I came from somewhere other than the theatre. So I worked in TV, but some of the audience are good fans of cartoons and animated content on TV. So I used to work in animation, and then I saw the opportunity to make the animation sort of come outside of the screen. So I got bored of just having one screen, and I thought it'd be nice to have multiple screens, or better still, just put content and graphics and visuals, exciting stuff, imagery everywhere, really. I got involved with some people who are doing projection in theatre. Now, it's a lot harder than making content just for a screen, but it's a lot more fun. It's so much more fun because actually, it can sometimes be a tool that you don't really recognize to be video. It's like in disguise, video in disguise. So it can be light. And in the production that I worked on with Tessa, it can also be a character. And in fact, in that production, it's light, character, and set. So it's a really, really, really flexible medium. And it doesn't just have to look like telly content on a telly-shaped surface. It can sort of go a little bit everywhere. I don't know what Tessa's showing you at the moment. She might be showing you something about Bob,
Should I show you
but she might.
something about Bob? I can make that happen. Here we go.
Yeah, sure. Let's do the Bob pictures because I'm talking about Bob. So Bob is a little blob of light, and the show is basically designed for younger audiences to talk a little bit about what it feels like to lose a really good friend and how you can sort of work around that and make that a positive thing in your life, or how to talk about it. It's a really healthy thing to do. So we had a lot of fun making it, and Amy, the director, basically came to me and said, "I want to make a show where light can be a character." So I said to her, "Okay, great, I'm up for that. I'm up for a challenge. You have to be if you work in theatre. You have to be up for a challenge, and I'm up for problem solving. That's something I really, really like to do, and I like to problem solve with lots of other people." So we had two brilliant actors who helped us to solve that problem, and also a brilliant puppeteer who helped us to animate Bob as if he was a a character. And we also worked with a bunch of coders who were really clever at making Bob do various things, all activated with a sort of bionic glove. It's like, you know, we had basically a robot controlling a ball of light. It was just a cool show.
Very cool. And
I really hope you come and see it when it goes out on the road. We also use lots of colours and it's fun, and lots of movement, dance. It's a really good piece. It's just the kind of thing I wanted to make when I came into theatre, really. Mm. I think when I was very young, I had a sort of a very clear picture of me about the age of 7, same age as my daughter is at the moment. And I was sort of up a ladder, wearing a pair of dungarees with my hair up in a sort of handkerchief thing, painting blobs onto a piece of wood. Mm. And so that was me doing scenic painting, basically.
Yeah.
But it took me a couple of decades to get back round to there. I think the main thing is, you know, if you enjoy theatre and you want to get involved, you should try and get involved in whichever way you want to get involved, because, you know, you can go and work in telly and still come into theatre. So so that's really fun. And it's quite, well, when I started, no one trained in video design or projection design, or, you know, people spent a lot of time joining kit together that wasn't really supposed to be joined together, but there wasn't really a profession. Now we've come to a place where it is a proper profession, proper job. Not that, again, my parents would call it a proper job. That's great.
Even when you're a lecturer at RADA, it's all part of it.
Exactly. So now I'm a teacher. Even my kids think I've got a proper job. So I do teach the course at RADA, along with a colleague of mine, Timothy Bird, who's absolutely brilliant. And we have a brilliant time there. And people are getting more and more involved with video in theatre. Yeah, it's a really exciting place to be.
It's great. And do you mind me asking, kind of, when you were kind of experimenting with different things and the journey that took you to this point of being a video and projection designer, what did that path look like? Did you try out lots of other different mediums, and did you come away completely, you know, you said you did your animation, was it all animation, or did you try, you know, other
really good
as well?
Question. Yeah, so I mean, for me, my route to theatre feels quite direct, but to other people, it doesn't at all. If you look at my career, basically, when I was at school, I did lots of art. I was really good at drawing. I've probably forgotten how to draw now, if I'm honest. I did loads of drawing, and I was always interested in pictures and how they were made. And I also did a lot of theatre. I was on stage, which I won't ever be again, quite frankly. Not if I can avoid it. I really, really enjoyed that, and I really enjoyed music. Then through my studies, I decided to postpone doing art, so leave it for a while and do something that I could fall back on it if I, you know, lost my eyesight or something. Mm. And so I did French and German, which was great, because really it's another sort of storytelling, another sort of language. Mm. And I've been able to use those languages when I've gone away from my work to other countries, which is great. And then I decided to go to art college. And quite quickly I moved from the painting side of things through to graphics and computer graphics and painting with computers. Mm. Then I sort of went into the world and sort of like, oh, what do I do? The only thing that really uses moving graphics is TV at that point. Mm-hmm. So I worked for the BBC and Turner Cartoons, Cartoon Network. And then eventually that's the point at which I sort of thought, you know, well, I've got a French and German degree and I've got a master's from an art college. And I've got some background in telly. Mm-hmm. But something's sort of missing. I was missing the sculptural element, I think, of putting image and surface together. Mm-hmm. And I used to carry on painting. And, you know, I love painting my kids' faces, for example. So I like painting funny objects. So
it's that kind of 3D, you know, that 3D element, which you must have not got, you know, from,
yeah,
from
that totally. It's the marriage of
animation. Yeah,
that's right. It's the marriage of picture to surface, really, that I really, really enjoy. And it's always surprising. And you have to also let yourself just go with that surprise sometimes. You know, if something good happens in the theatre, just because it's not what you planned, doesn't mean you shouldn't investigate why it's happened and whether it's actually a really beautiful thing to help you tell your story, really.
What I really loved about working with you on the Bob project was that even when, as we've just discovered, setting up this Zoom meeting, when things go completely unpredictably at the last minute, having set it up a few hours before working perfectly, you're so pragmatic and able to just go, okay, that doesn't work, but this might, so let's just try this and da da da. And I think that's obviously from a career that's used a lot of technology, but for me, just that kind of that problem-solving ability that you said at the start that you really enjoy, it was so evident in that process, and you could see that. You know, where most people would be tearing their hair out, you were kind of buzzing off it almost. You know, I'm sure there were really stressful elements, but
It's
that was
important
what
that
I
you
really
choose
enjoyed
a.
watching.
Oh, good. Well, I mean, I think it's important that whatever you do as a career or whatever you get involved with, and even just as a hobby, you have to enjoy it enough to be able to get out of the bad situations and get enough out of it to enjoy it. And it's very rewarding when it all does work, you know. I sit in a pile of cables and you can't see it. A lot of it's on the floor because of our little rummage
Looks
earlier.
remarkably tidy from here. Well
Very lot
choreographed.
of and my studio is sort of, you know, boxes of cables, and I'm thinking, oh, I can't give that one away. And then suddenly I find a hard drive that I've had for, you know, 15 years, and I'm like, oh, I bet that's got some really brilliant photos on it. Let's see if I've looked in my box, go and see if I can get the cables. I like joining things together. I shouldn't be joined together.
I wonder, maybe I should play this video. We were talking about projecting and using unconventional spaces. Could you want to just talk a little bit about the Lego project that you
Yeah,
did in
absolutely.
lockdown?
We can't get into the theatres, and like a lot of theatre makers, I don't say I work at or I work for. I say I am. I'm very much an I am. So I am a maker and I am a projection designer, and it means that if I'm not doing that, I feel a bit sad. Like a lot of people at the moment. So to stop myself from feeling sad and to find something that the kids could get involved with too, I set myself the task of doing something for the Clap for Carers moment. It was a Tuesday, I think, and I wanted to get it ready for the Thursday. And I've always wanted to projection map Lego, and it's all about having fun. So that's what I did with the kids, and it had to all be done in a day so that they could build it and enjoy it. And then when they came to destroy it the next day, which my youngest does all the time, then I'd have done my job. And also, I wanted to have that sense of collaboration that I've been missing outside of the theatre, where it's not just about my ideas, because then things would be very boring, I think. But the kids had different ideas about how this thing should be built. So I tried to combine those all together and make a piece that sort of means something for right now, keeps my skills in.
It's really beautiful. Okay, I'm going to keep everything crossed that this tech is going to work. And let's watch it.
A really important thing to say actually about that is that the wonderful Sebastian Frost did the sound for that, and so I'm really grateful to him for that,
Oh, it
because
all
without
came
the
together
sound it
so
wouldn't
nicely.
yeah it wouldn't be half as meaningful. So he did a really brilliant job on that.
Oh, it's so gorgeous. It's just so exciting, you know, especially if you're not used to seeing video mapping as well. It just looks like complete wizardry. And the fact that you can pull that off in a day is with two children under the age of 8 is something of a miracle, I would say, frankly.
I think the thing is you feel it inside and you go for it because you get flushed, you know, and hot with the endeavor. You sort of go for it. And actually it's really rewarding when a couple of years ago one of my daughters came to one of my shows and there was this one moment that she'd seen sort of evolving on my computer for a while, and then we were in the theater and it happened on the stage, which was sort of an unexpected layer that she didn't sort of imagine to happen. It was when a puppet came to life and became projection, and she just turned around to me and she was like, mummy, when did you become magic? And I was like,
you're like, mummy points, yes.
Mummy points, yeah. I only do it for the mummy points.
Yes, exactly.
I'm away the whole time. So when I come back or when they come to into the theatre, it has to be mummy points.
Exactly, yeah. And when they're teenagers and suddenly it's not cool anymore, you'll be like, do you know what? I stored up all those mummy points when you're little, so look at my pot of mummy points.
Yeah, exactly. When I'm mentoring them through their first tech.
Yes.
Who knows? Do you want me to do that little demo?
I would love to see a little demo. Yes, please.
Okay.
Let's go over here.
I hope it's going to work. Yeah. So let me know when it's all good.
I think it's good. Yeah.
Okay. So talking about projection mapping on toys, I thought, well, I'll have a go at something just so that you guys can see what projection can do. Because as I've mentioned, it's a light. It can look like painting. It can fall onto any object and make a different story surrounding that object. So I got my daughter's toy and tried to stop it from being nicked over the last couple of hours. That's my main endeavour. So this is Snowball, and Snowball is going to be projection mapped. The camera on my iPhone is probably not going to do a very good job of making it like work properly, but let's just see if we can put some colour into this dude. So this dude, I think, I'm not sure about the colour, so I'm just going to see if I can give... that's not coming up. Is it coming up? Yeah, here we go.
Oh, wow.
Going to make her pink. Snowball, here we go. Now I'm using Photoshop. Now normally I would be using video software like After Effects or something like that, then I'd be able to make it all move and stuff like that, but at the moment I'm just using Photoshop and just color it pink a little bit, and then I think I want to get some different color inside the ears, so that one's going to be like maybe yellow. Let's do something properly crazy. Let's do some yellow in there. I've got to make all the colours quite dark because it otherwise isn't really properly. But let's have a look. Put some yellow in there. Yeah, yellow ears. Little yellow nose, do we think?
Yes.
Maybe I need a different brush for that. I'm going to use just a normal brush for that. Quite small. Oh, that's massive. Oopsie. It doesn't have to also just be necessarily painting. It can be... Let's just make it nice and small. That's good to give us a nose. That's quite a funny nose. It's not quite in the right position. You can sort of see. You can also do things like, let's get a costume involved, shall we? So let's take this and put that here, maybe. Give him a little costume.
That's amazing.
I'm going to transform this so that it sort of goes in the right place. It needs to be a bit smaller. There we go. Little dude there. There we go. So he's got a little jacket. Shame about the contrast ratio. You're not going to see it in its full glory, but there we go. And then where's my drawing? There we go. I'm going to draw some more stuff. Put that under the coat. There we go. Let's save that. Let's get back to the drawing. Oh, it wants to do something else. It wants to do something entirely different. It's not playing ball. It doesn't always behave. Maybe yellow tummy, do we think?
Yeah.
Yeah, yellow tummy. And I mean, I'm using quite a thick brush and you're not really seeing, I'll take a photo of this so you guys can see it better later, because it doesn't look quite so blown out. But basically I can probably dim it down and then it'll look better.
Oh yeah.
There we go. Now you can see the yellow. Mm. See, that is the liveness that I love. I love to problem solve. There it is live. There's Tessa's, she's absolutely right. I'm a problem solver trying to make this work for you. There we go. You can probably see the jacket coming into four. Now there he is.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, great. A bit more pink on the face, maybe.
It really does look magic to me.
A little bit magic. There he is, a bit more. I sort of moved the projector, didn't I? A little bit. Yeah, like, oh no, I moved the canvas. That's what I did. I've done this before. There we go. There he is. It's a bit better. I'm not very practiced at drawing anymore. I mostly use computers, so it's gone a little bit. I've lost my touch a little bit on that.
It's the most handsome disco bunny I've ever seen.
Disco bunny. Yeah, and I mean, you can do pretty much anything with light. I like to say, as long as there's surface there, and that's where collaboration is really, really important, because you know you've got to be able to work as part of a team and enjoy that process of problem solving together, because then you come up with something that's really kind of new and different. I could also potentially get those tapes in the background that are a little bit boring, put a colour on those maybe. So it doesn't have to be all just sort of painting, it can be.
And when you're seeing this on, you know, are you doing this from looking at the actual bunny, or have you mapped it onto a screen that you're looking at?
It's a combination of things. So I am looking at my drawing tablet, which I have in front of me. And I'm then looking back. Actually, that's the other thing, is that I'm looking back at the stage, as it were, a lot of the time, to check what I'm doing. Mm. And I used to wear glasses, and I don't wear glasses anymore. And I wondered why that was. And the doctor said to me, "Well, it's because you stretch your eyes now."
You're constantly going from short to long sight.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm going from near to far all the time, and I don't have to sort of worry about my eyes just being there as a static sort of a screen. Mm. So actually, it's improved my eyesight. Imagine that. It's good for your health as well as being bad for
your health. This is going to be kids listening up for health advice. It's brilliant.
Yeah, so as I don't know, I can't really see the questions. So
shall I start pinging them to you? Do you want to keep working on Bunny, or should we go back to you?
Yeah, I'll maybe keep working, you know.
Okay, cool.
Nice.
So we've got a nice one here from Alexandra.
Hello.
Where do you think technology will take you in the future with theatre?
What a good question. Well, there's a lot of discussion about that at the moment, actually, we're obviously all outside of the theatre, and we want to have that collective experience. And people have experimented a lot with sort of VR and things like that. But there are sort of problems with that, because, you know, when you put a headset on, you're sort of shut away from the world, and you don't really have that collective experience. So what I'm going to try and do, and I've started to do with a few friends, is look at where technology can help us to all have a collective experience, but sort of be in the collective experience together. And that's probably using a combination of augmented reality, mixed reality delivery. We'll be exploring what feels right. I mean, because I think there's a lot of live stream productions that are great, but they're missing a huge chunk of what it is to be there and sit and watch a theatre show. So I'm looking to develop those, for not just for the pandemic kind of scenario, but also to sort of pandemic proof the theatre industry a little bit. Mm. And additionally also to get these shows out to a greater audience, because some of it comes down to money, really, because theatres, have a limited size of auditorium, so the pieces of theatre that we can make and the ambition that we can make happen in the theatre is always limited by the budgets. Mm-hmm. But if you have a wider viewership, more akin to a cinema viewership, then you're going to be, you've got a wider audience that's paying more money. So in theory, you can make more ambitious stuff, and that then feeds the technology. And I always said that code's very important, but yeah, virtual technologies, immersive technologies are a really big thing at the moment.
Yeah, it's interesting that, you know, it feels a little bit like everyone's starting to throw their hat in the ring for digital, you know, working digitally, but actually there's people like you who've been working on this for decades, and yeah. now you're finally kind of getting the spotlight's really on that kind of technology and what you do, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. And I think you know, that's why it's so important for designers and technicians to be involved in the conversations about how we move forward, because it's all very well a producer or an artistic director trying to have a guess about how it works, but actually we can help, basically. Mm. You know, we can come up with hopefully some good ideas. I think I'm done with Bunny for now. I can't really draw and talk.
Okay, cool.
So I'm happy to go back for you to go back to me if you want. I raise the blind a bit. I live in the dark. That's what I do. There we go.
I know. I've kind of realised by not touring at this time of year, I've got a tan for the first time in many years.
So strange,
because yeah, I've not been in the dark, kind of, yeah, in a black box.
Yeah. Totally true.
Cool. I've got another question from Holly here. She says, what is your dream play to make a projection work for?
Oh, I wish I thought of that. It changes all the time.
Does it?
It is all the time. And sometimes there are plays that are out there and you're like, oh, that person got it. So the ones that I've enjoyed, let's start with the ones I've enjoyed most in terms of the richness of the narrative. I enjoy Alice's Adventures Underground, and I made an immersive version of that a few years ago that was really, really fun to make. I think things that offer a lot of imagination are really great. So I've done a Midsummer Night's Dream, but I'd like to do another one. I've never done a magic flute, so I'd like to do one of those. Both of those, I'd say the opera versions of those would be really fun to do. Mm. I really wanted to do Frozen the musical.
Oh.
Because it's just, I mean, it's all there. Like,
yeah, that must feature kids, pretty big in your house with two children under eight, you know.
Definitely, and I would have got the biggest mum points for that.
Yeah.
I would have loved to have done that. But yeah, anything that challenges me to do something that you can't normally do on stage. Mm. I mean, I think my first show ever was, it was a score which was a couple of hundred years old, but it was peppered with references to, and you know, and then a flood takes over the stage, and then there's a bolt of lightning, and then everything catches fire, and I'm like, oh yeah, go on. So anything with great imagination, I take suggestions, and I'll try and make it happen.
Amazing. And have you ever worked with water or ice? You know, I was thinking with Frozen, and what happens when you project onto those surfaces?
It's really fun, actually. So I worked with a water curtain when I was at Chichester Festival Theatre. Mm. And that was a really lovely effect because it was permeable, so people can come in and go through it. It was also a sort of elemental force, which was really nice. And also the imagery was really sort of, it became more three-dimensional. But also harder to really get what it was. Mm. So it took it away from being literal. I mean, I hate screens. I really hate just a screen. So I think anything that's not literal is great. Ice would be fun. I've only ever projected onto thick perspex before, which I think would have the same effect.
Yeah.
Because you sort of project onto it and the light goes into it and sort of there's an internal glow.
Wow.
And that's really a beautiful thing to play with. So yeah, ice would be good. I do dancing on ice just like a shot, but I think their graphics are more like visuals and graphics. So I'd like to do something really beautiful on ice. It'd be really good.
You're more exciting than dancing on ice. You're, you know, that's a little bit too elementary for you, I think, Nina.
You've never seen me on ice. I'm dreadful.
I'm going to do another call out for questions. If anyone's watching and they've got a question to ask, we've got a few more minutes before... before the end of the interview today. And I feel super lucky to have had this chance to ask you these questions that I haven't even been able to do working with you. It's great. I'd quite like to know, of all the different kind of scales and mediums, is there one that you find the most challenging, and is there one that is the most rewarding, you know, due to those sizes, or is it kind of project to project?
Well, I do love working on musicals. It seems to have a lot going for it in terms of the elements that you can bring to it, and the process that you can put into play in order to put those things together can be at the sort of higher end of things sometimes. We were about to open City of Angels in the West End, and I had 9 to 5 running in the West End as well. And from a person's process point of view, over the last 10, 12 years that I've been doing video in theatre, I think that's the time I was really best able to put all of those best practice things in place, because there was an element of budget sort of elevation that allowed me to just go, I know this is how it should be done, so therefore let's do it like this, let's really do it properly. And then they get a brilliant end result. I really enjoyed working in Panto for the first time. It was very silly, and there was a lot of glitter, and hopefully there'll be a bit more of that. Mark Walters and I won the Great British Panto Awards Best Set Design this year, which was like, wow, amazing.
Yay!
And so it's quite nice that, you know, video is recognised alongside set design in that way. But musicals are brilliant. I love opera because you can be so poetic.
And epic, I guess that's opera.
And
thing,
epic,
isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, everything has to be like slowed down 500 times, because it's, you can't be slow enough in opera. It has to be all the way. Moving, or maybe that's just Strauss and Wagner that I've been mostly dealing with, or, you know, but I love opera because there's high concept, amazing visual pictures that you can create. It's really, really fun. This is the reason why I work on all scales, because I really like the challenges that each presents.
And a question that I'm kind of putting out to a lot of our interviewees each week is, say there is someone watching who goes, actually, this is it. I've tried being in plays, whether they might be a child or an adult, you know, they've tried being on the stage. And this is something our designer Lena said last week. She tried being on stage and realized quite quickly that that wasn't for her, like you said. But how would you say, what would be the next step if you've gone, okay, I love theatre and, you know, this actually looks like a perfect avenue for me that doesn't involve being on stage but involves so much creativity. What should they do next?
It's true. I watched Lena's interview as well, and she said she didn't enjoy being on stage. I mean, I have to say, I'm the same. I had this terrible sense of nerves when I was on stage. I think I stopped being on stage sort of when I was at university. Like, you gain inhibitions at that point as well. So what I would say is go and try everything, because you never know where you're going to find your niche. As I say to all my first year students at the beginning of the year, RADA, I say, so why are you here? And, you know, and then I use that as a way of telling them how they're not going to escape having to confront video in their careers, because it crosses all the different platforms, all the different creative strands. You know, you're going to have to talk to video if this video on the show somehow. So I do that. And then at the end, I ask them the same question, you know, have things evolved? And, you know, some of them say, yeah, I really want to do video now. And some of them say, oh, yeah, I thought I was going to do stage management, but now I'm really interested in lighting. So I would say, just see what takes your fancy, see whether just try everything. And then it might be that you're combining things to create a whole new strand of art within theatre or art anywhere. And just look at lots of, watch lots of theatre and try and think about what you like about it, and then do some research, find out how that thing was made. And if you don't know, if you've got no idea how it was made, it's probably video.
It's probably a really clever person like you. And do you think you're putting your daughters off from going into theatre, or do you think you're buzzing them up to it? How would you feel if they my mum was a teacher, and she always said that she would never let me be a teacher because she knew how hard it was. And if I ever said, oh, I want to be a teacher like you, she was like, wrong, give me another idea. Like, what's your daughter's? I know they're very young, but do they have a relationship with it yet?
Yeah, totally. I mean, my daughters started to really appreciate theatre around the age of three. I mean, before then, they would come to the theatre, or they would be snuck into the theatre while I had to work or whatever. Mm. My youngest came to Russia with me when she was 5 months old. So that was a little young for opera. But they you know, how kids understand the world through role play. And so they role play a lot. Quite often they role play around theatre, and it's normally them being on stage, but there's an element of them making the stage ready.
That's great,
which is kind of cool to see. There's singing and prancing around and all that sort of thing. And I think I'm over this lockdown, I've been able to introduce my eldest to computer drawing a little bit, and she's really into that. I wouldn't discourage them from doing it at all. I don't know how I'd feel if they said they wanted to be on stage. That's like, you know, a whole different strand. Yeah. I can't really advise on, you know. But the main thing is, you know, if they've got an interest, I would support them in that interest, even if it meant going into theatre.
Yeah, they wouldn't. They couldn't be better placed than having, you know, having you there, and just that project that you showed us earlier with the Lego. They build the thing, and then you show them what can be done. I bet that looked like absolute magic. Do they think it was cool? Were they like, you know?
Yeah, they thought it was cool, actually. Okay. I mean, they'd seen me a week or two before in lockdown trying to angle a projector at our house to do some sort of, to project their illustrations and stuff. So they're used to me sort of getting a bit lost in my tinkering. But once they got over I think that's the thing, basically. They lose me to it. They really do lose me to my career a lot. Mm. But then the moments when I can bring them back into it, and I can get them involved and excited and get them to appreciate it and ask questions, then that's a really, really good moment. And they thought it was cool. You know, when they came to see 9 to 5, they thought that was cool. And they basically think they're due a visit to 9 to 5 every month. So let's get it back in the theatre.
Yes.
And they really remember all of these things, hopefully. At the very least, it gives them access to a different way of thinking. Because I guess I come from a family of engineers and doctors. And there was no real artist career path. I was sort of, she's just an artist. You know, I mean, no disrespect to my family, because they were supportive. They let me do whatever I liked. And then saw what I made of it. And so far, I haven't mucked it up too badly. So I think they're quite happy now that I've found my place. Although, again, you know, with this lockdown, there's a sort of sense of, oh, well, it's a precarious place to be. But no, it's not. We as theatre makers can reinvent ourselves. And, you know, the moment lockdown happened, sure, I started making some more projections. I've been making masks, you know.
It's a great big problem to try and solve, yeah, isn't it?
Yeah, and so I think if anyone can problem solve their way out of this, then we theatre makers can. Come on, everyone.
Yes. I've got lots of other questions, but I think that's a really lovely note to end on. And I've been saying with all these interviews, if any of you guys watching have any questions after this, then put them in the comments, and I can always send Nina an email or a WhatsApp to put those questions to her. If you're not watching this live, or something comes to you afterwards, that would be amazing.
Yeah, and I can always write in the comments, can't I? Because at the moment, just so everyone knows, I'm not on the Facebook. I can't see the Facebook stuff.
Yeah, the technicalities of it all means that I'm the puppet master and you're talking at yourself, basically, aren't you?
But it's true. But I mean, one round of applause for Tessa's tech. My God, amazing work. When you said, oh, I'll set us up on this and show you how it all works, I couldn't quite believe to what extent you got to make it. And then I said, oh, let's use a third screen as well. Yeah, let's just put that one in 5 minutes to go.
I mean, it's every week, you know, it comes on leaps and bounds. So by the end of this, I'm going to be, you know, some sort of crazy technical wizard. But that's 3 weeks ago, I'd never done Facebook Live. So this is
life
what
skills.
Lockdown is for, isn't it?
Yeah.
Great. Thank you so much, Nina.
Thanks so much.
Yeah. And keep well. And I hope your children do as too. Thank you so much.
And everyone out there too.
Thank you.
Great, take care. Bye.
Bye. I'm going to stay with you just for a second to just remind you that this is only one of the things that we've got going on digitally during lockdown. We're putting in all of our normal gigging energy to bring you guys stuff online. So right now we have Perfect available to stream online. So we've been sharing that since Monday because we've been collaborating with Omnibus Theatre, who helped us make the show, and it's online for the whole of half term, and it's going to be up next week as well. You can see our little Perfect online there. Perfect was the first show that I actually used projection in. It was an adaptation of a children's book of the same name by Nicola Davis, and we worked with illustration and animation students from UWE, which is one of the local universities here, who adapted those illustrations from the book and made them into animations that then were projected onto the onto a curved psych. Which is like a screen, a curved screen that kind of hugs the stage. It is mega beautiful, and I would really love it if you could watch it. We've got a captioned version and a non-captioned version. So that's up there for the next couple of weeks up here. Every Wednesday, we've got our Meet the Team Wednesday. Next Wednesday is going to be Peter Moritz. Peter is an actor and a theatre maker, a puppeteer. She does a lot of improv. She's in a few improv groups. And she would have been touring this year with the Anarchist Mobile Library. So we're going to be meeting Peter and hearing about her career next Wednesday. And then every other Friday, we've got puppetry workshops and performance workshops being sent out as well. So a couple of weeks ago, I put out the first one, which is a puppetry making workshop, where you only need newspaper and masking tape and you can make your very own puppet that looks like this. Hang on. Oh, no, he's stuck. There we go. This is what he looks like. Hi, guys. So you can meet this guy, you can make one of him. Yeah, la la la. You can make him with this puppetry workshop. And I've recorded one to go out this Friday, which is going to be a basics of puppeteering workshop. So that's going to be streamed this Friday. And then we've got more coming up every other Friday. And then I've even got live storytelling happening every other Sunday. So I'll be reading the Book of Perfect and some other stories in the making to make shows of as well. So there's heaps going on to keep you guys entertained. And what we're doing is we're putting out all this content, and we're paying all of our the team members to do their little Wednesday meetups in the hope that we could get some donations from you guys who are enjoying it. So if you're able to, and if you've been appreciating this content, then I'm going to put up a little link now, and it's in the comments as well, in the description, a link to our fundraising page. You can donate the price of a coffee, £3, or as many coffees as you like, to help us going, because at the moment we don't have any extra funding. This is all coming out of our existing pot, so that would, yeah, that's going to keep us going for as long as possible, which would be amazing. So stay well, enjoy this sunshine, and I'll be seeing you live next Wednesday with Peter Moritz. Have a lovely week. Thank you. Bye.